Okay, now we'll see how the light dependent resistor can be connected to the Raspberry Pi. So here we are studying about the light dependent resistor, and this is the picture of the light dependent resistor, that is how it looks. The program here we are studying is to use the LDR sensor, which reads the intensity of light and records it in a text file. This resistor will read the intensity of light and records it in a text file. So this is a light dependent resistor. That means more the resistance to the light, more the voltage can flow through it. So that is we are calculating the voltage, how much amount of voltage it is flowing through when the light different intensities of lights are passed on it. So let us see how we can make use of this light dependent resistor. So here the connections are made like this. We can see here the connections. This is the light dependent resistor, which is connected along with a capacitor. Capacitor one end is grounded, the other end is connected to the one of the ends of the light dependent resistor, and one end of the light dependent resistor is connected to the power supply, and the other end of the resistor is connected through this wire to the Raspberry Pi. You can see through here it is going here, moving. So it will reach the connections are made here. It is pin number 3 of the Raspberry Pi. Okay, so one end of the resistor is connected to the power supply, the other end is connected to the GPIO of Raspberry Pi, pin number 3, and the capacitor is also connected. So these are the connections made here. So here you can see this is the pin number 3 in the pin diagram. This is pin number 3 to which the light dependent resistor is connected. This is the program we are writing for finding the light intensity, how much light is passed through the resistor, and we are calculating it. So this is the program we are writing. So let us see the program here. So this part of the program, which we have already discussed, import OS. So here we are taking date and time to display date and time. So time is for introducing the delay. Then RPI.GPIO as GPIO. We have seen this to make use of GPIO pins. And set warnings is set to false in order to avoid annoying warnings. Then there is a flag debug, which is set to 1. Then GPIO.setMode is GPIO.BCM, that is Broadcom. Then here we are writing a function. Okay, this is a function which is designed to set up the GPIO pins. Okay, this function is used to set up the GPIO pins. So here we can see reading is a variable which is set to 0, local variable. The name of the function is RC time. Name of the function is RC time, and it is taking one parameter, RC pin. Okay, so what is this RC pin? It is the name of the variable which is accepting the value when the function is called. So where the function is called, you can see here, RC time of 3. The function RC time is called here, and the parameter passed is 3. So when you pass that 3 to RC time, it will reach this RC pin. That value 3 will reach the RC pin, which will be made use of in this function. Okay, so then reading equal to 0, then GPIO dot setup equal RC pin comma GPIO out. That means this RC pin, which is pin number 3, which is passed as a parameter here, will be received here, and which will be set as an output pin. Okay, the pin number 3 is set as an output pin, then for that output pin, what value we are setting is low. Okay, on that output pin, the value set is low. Then a delay is introduced. Then GPIO.setup RC pin GPIO in. So then it will be made as input pin. So first it will be made as output pin, and there it is set to low, and now it is made as an input pin. So we know that GPIO pins can be made as both input and output pin. So now the same pin is made as an input pin, and here a loop is executed. So this loop takes about 1 millisecond per iteration. Okay, so in 1 millisecond, one iteration of this loop will be executed. Okay, one iteration of this loop will be executed. What is this loop? While GPIO.input of RC pin equal to low. So when it is low, here we have already made it low, right? So we are checking here when it is equal to low, reading plus equal to 1. That means, so here that resistor, when light falls on it, it keeps increasing its value, that is this GPIO pin value, until it reaches a high value. Okay, it keeps increasing its value until it reaches a threshold high value. It keeps increasing. Okay, so then when it reaches some threshold, it will take that value as the final value, means that voltage can pass through it. Okay, so that it every time until it becomes high, until it reaches the threshold, the reading keeps incrementing by 1. So after the GPIO becomes high, then that reading value will be sent as a output from the function, return value of the function. Okay, so first we will set it to low, then after 1 second it will be made as an input pin, and then it will be checked whether it is equal to low, and then if it is equal to low, it will be incremented until it becomes high each time. So one iteration of the loop will be 1 millisecond. So very fast it will detect the light, and it will reach the threshold and give you a value what voltage it can pass through it. Okay, so that is how this loop is executed. So that is this loop. Okay, so this is the same explanation. So this is the function, this is the loop. Okay, now this is this part. Okay, this part, what we have another while loop here, is explained here. While true means it will become an infinite loop. Okay, while true means it will become an infinite loop. So when it is true, get date and time. So we need to get the date and time in this format. Okay, so this is for taking now, means current time. We will take in this format, that is YMD, year, month, date format, and hour, minute, second format. In this format, date and time will be taken and will be stored in get date and time, get date time variable. Then LDR reading equal to RC time of 3. So this is where we are calling the function. Okay, this is where we are calling the RC time function, and whatever the value it returns, this reading value, what reading value this function is returning, that will be stored in this LDR reading. Okay, so then that LDR reading will be printed here. Okay, so the RC time of 3, that will be printed. Then we need to open a file, because we have seen that it will store that value in a file. We need to store that value in a file, what reading has been taken by that light detection resistor. So then we have to open a file. We have taken a variable FO to handle that file. So open the file. The name of the file is given in this path. The name of the file is foo.txt, which is residing in home, pi, desktop, GPIO Python code, foo.txt. This is the name of the file, and this is the whole path of the file. And this file will be opened in WB mode. What is this WB mode? WB mode means write binary. So we have seen read mode, write mode, read write mode, isn't it? So this is WB mode, which is write binary. So this file will be opened in write mode, and what we can write, we can write the binary data. Okay, so that will be opened, and the handle is fo for this file. Okay, so then fo.write means this file will be handled here by fo, and it is accessed for writing. What we are writing? Get date time. So what we have accepted here in this format, that will be written onto this file. Okay, so then LDR reading equal to str of LDR reading. So what is this str of LDR reading? This value which we have received from this file, reading value, that will be converted to string format and is stored in LDR reading. Okay, this is just string format conversion. And then just write a slash n. So first it will write the current date and time in the file, then it will take a slash n, means it will go to the next line. In the next line it will write LDR reading, which is converted to the string format. Okay, what data we have received from the function RC time, that will be written into the file here by this statement. Okay, after that we will have to close the opened file by using fo.close. So it will open, it will close the file. Then time.sleep1, it will wait for 1 second and program ends. So now what value we have read from the light resistor, that is also displayed on the screen because of this, and also written into the file. Okay, so let us see how this program executes. So here okay, this is same explanation what I just gave you. Okay, these are the connections, how on the board it is made. This is the light dependent resistor, capacitor. One end is connected to the ground, the other end is connected through this wire to the Raspberry Pi, and the capacitor is connected. So now we'll have to execute. For executing, first we will create the foo.txt. So here that foo.txt is existing. Then we will use the sudo python command for execution of the file, sudo python and name of the file. Then in the normal light, what we are seeing here in the normal light, the values given are 80 78 80 78, because little variation in the light intensity happens. So approximate values 80, 78, 79 is being displayed one after the other. The readings will be keep displaying because it is an infinite loop, right? In the last program we have seen this is an infinite loop, so it keeps repeating. Okay, so it will keep printing the the values, reading values, in the file also as well as on the screen also. So it keeps printing one after the other. So here in the normal light, but when you put, see, like from the mobile, flashlight is on and it is placed on the resistor, so then it will take the, it will not allow much voltage to flow through it, so the value is little decreased. When it is exposed to the light, the reading will be decreased. Okay, so previous reading is around 80 79 80, but now it is decreased. Okay, then when you make it complete dark, okay, there is no light, then again it is increasing. See here 83 89, around 90, the maximum recorded value is 90, so till 90 it reached. Okay, so this is how the light dependent resistor is resisting the light and allowing the voltage to flow through it. So more the resistance, more the voltage can flow through it. So by looking at these values, it makes it clear. So now again, if you put some light on the resistor, so now you can see the voltage readings are less, and so it got decreased. So now it was 88 89 90, but after you put some light on the resistor, the value, voltage value gets decreased. So that is how the light dependent resistor works. Is that clear? So we have also seen that we are not only displaying the reading on the screen, but we are also storing it in a file, right? So we'll see how the value is stored in a file. So look at more foo.txt to display the contents of the file foo.txt. So here the date and time in the format which we had given in the program, right? So you can see here in this format we had taken the date and time, and it was written into the file, right? And also the reading is written onto the file in the next line. So that output you can see here. So first line the date and time, in the next line the last reading of the resistor will be recorded in the file. So that is how it works. The next one is the passive infrared sensor, which is interfaced to the Raspberry Pi. So these sensors will allow you to sense motion of an object. So motion detection, this is used for motion detection. If anything, any object comes in front of this sensor, it will detect. So this is used to detect whether a human has moved in or out of the sensor's range. So within the range of the sensor, if any object or human is detected, it will if any human or object comes in the range of the sensor, then it will detect the motion of the object or the human. So let us see how you can interface it with the Raspberry Pi. So these are the connections made here. You can see it has 3 pins. Okay, so in the previous slide we have seen, no, it has 3 pins. Yeah, here it has 3 pins, right? So what these 3 pins are connected to? So these 3 pins are connected to, one is connected to the power supply with red cable, you can see. The other one is connected with a black cable for the ground, and the middle one, which is the yellow color wire, which is connected to the GPIO of the Raspberry Pi. Okay, so one is for the power supply, another is for the ground, and the center one, middle one, is for the GPIO connection of the Raspberry Pi. So that is how the connections are made, and this is the program written. So here in this program you can see these things we already have discussed. This is the interpreter line, then this is the GPIO settings, then time for delay introduction, then set mode Broadcom, then warnings are set to false, then set up 27 GPIO.out. Do you remember this 27 pin and 17 pin? Both we have connected LEDs, right? We had connected LEDs for 27 pin and 17 pin. So here also we are using that connection. 27 pin is set as output pin. So why we are using LED here is, whenever a motion is detected by the sensor, then LED will also glow. So such a kind of a program we are writing here. Hence this 27th pin LED connection is also made use of in this program. Okay, then GPIO.PIR is a variable which is set for the value 7 pin number. Then it will print PIR module test control C to exit. Okay, this is just a normal message which will be displayed on the screen. Then the setup, that is the pin number 7, is made as an input pin. Okay, so motion need to be detected, right? So it is made as an input pin. Then we have 2 more variables, current state and previous state, which are set to 0. Okay, current state and previous state, which are set to zeros. So why we need this current state and previous state is, current state means if motion is detected now, then it is change. Okay, the current state is changed, but previous state we also have to keep track of. So we will see how it is made use of in the program. Okay, so here we have a try block. So where we have the code print waiting for PIR to settle. Okay, passive infrared to settle, while that is a message which will be displayed. This will be a message which will be displayed while GPIO.input of GPIO PIR equal to 1. That means if any motion is detected, if it becomes 1, till then current state is set to 0. Okay, current state, until it any motion is detected, current state will be set to 0. Then you say print ready. We are ready for accepting the input to detect the motion. Okay, so then here the infinite loop starts. Then current state equal to whatever the input we get from that pin number 7, that will be stored in the current state. And if current state is equal to 1 and previous state equal to 0. Okay, so previous state means any previous detected, if previously action motion is detected, then it will be 1, right? So if it is 0, current state is 1 and previous state is 0, previously no motion is detected, currently motion is detected, then we print the statement motion detected. Okay, previous 0, current 1, so motion is detected. Okay, so motion is detected, that statement will be printed. Then GPIO output 27th pin will be set high. That means the LED will be set to high value, means it will glow for 1 second. Then LED will be off. Okay, it will be set to low value, then LED will be off. Then previous state will be set to 1 because it has detected a motion. So previous state will be set to 1. Otherwise, if this is not the case, if current state is not 1 and previous state is not 0, else if current state is 0 and previous state is 1, means previously already motion is detected, then we have to print ready and set the previous state to 0. Okay, so now we have to be ready again for accepting the new input. So we will set the previous state to 0 and we will print a message ready and 0.01 millisecond, 1 millisecond it will sleep for. Then accept keyboard interrupt, then print quit, then clean up. So this is how the program execute. So did you understand? If it will be current state will be 0, previous state will be 0. If any input is detected on this pin number 7, it will be 1, then current state will be 1. So if current state is 0, we will say ready. If current state is 1 and previous state is 0, we will print motion detected, then LED will glow for 1 second, then LED will be off, then previous state will be set to 1. But if previous state is 1, that means motion is already detected, and current state is 0, means no motion now, then we will say ready and we will set the previous state to 0 and we will wait for the input. Okay, so that is how the PIR sensor will work. So this is the PIR sensor pins, back side of the PIR sensor, the 3 pins which you can see here. This is for the VCC, that is power supply, this is for the ground, and this is for the output which is connected to the GPIO of the Raspberry Pi. So now let us see how execution happens. So here this is the PIR sensor placed. So no motion as of now, you can see here no motion. So it is still. So what it will display: PIR module test, control C to exit, waiting for PIR to settle. Then it will say ready. Okay, so now it is ready to detect the motion. So now when a hand is placed in front of the PIR sensor, then it will display motion detected. So some obstacle comes in front of the PIR sensor, then it will say motion detected. So that is how the PIR sensor will be used. So they are also very simple programs, right? So you can easily execute them on simulation softwares, or you can, if you have your Raspberry Pi, so you can execute them sensors and all. You can using hardware components also you can execute. So whatever I have discussed so far, all these execution screenshots and connection screenshots and the program screenshots, I would like to acknowledge Codecademy. I have taken these screenshots from their video. So they are very, very good videos, set of videos where all these programs are discussed. I will share the link with you in the Google Classroom. Please go through it, and if possible, please try to implement. So in Tinkercad also, you can implement the software, you can implement these programs. Please implement them and check. It will be real fun. Okay, so they are so nice programs, so well, so easy programs, Python programs. You can easily understand and execute. So here it completes the discussion of Raspberry Pi. Then we are left with only smart city architecture, which we will see in the next class. Thank you all. Have a good day. Bye. In the previous section, we have seen programs execution by interfacing several components like LED, push button, buzzer, temperature sensor and light sensor with Raspberry Pi. Here we will see how Raspberry Pi uses SSH protocol for communication with the computer. So SSH stands for Secure Shell. Now the question comes, what is SSH, right? You should know what is SSH. So to know what is SSH, let us see some history. Let us go back to around 1960s, where we didn't had the smartphones, we didn't had internet, we didn't had several gadgets for communication. So at that time, the communication between the computer computers were accessed through a protocol called as Telnet. So what is this Telnet? Telnet is one of the earliest remote login protocols on internet, released in early days of IP networking around 1969, and it was for a long time the default way to access remote network computers. It is a client server protocol. As it doesn't provide built-in security, it suffers from serious security issues and limited its usage on the internet, where network cannot be fully trusted, right? Internet cannot be fully trusted, so it has limited usage on the internet. So when the Telnet was used, there is a threat. As the security is very less, there is a threat that an unauthorized user may access the communication between the client and the server. So now, how SSH works? So now SSH provides a secure alternative to Telnet. So in the previous slide, we saw the Telnet protocol was used for remote login in the earlier days. So now there was no security. So for that purpose, Telnet spawned SSH, which provides a secure alternative to the Telnet. It protects users' identities, passwords and data from the network snooping attacks, and also allows secure login and file transfers. SSH has practically replaced the Telnet. So now to know how SSH works, let us view a small animation to know how SSH works.
Successor called Secure Shell or Where Telnet was like writing a note and sending it to your neighbor and anyone standing in between could read it, SSH had a different approach. First, you and your neighbor agree to use a briefcase. Then you put your note inside the briefcase, put a lock on it, and send it to your neighbor. Since your neighbor doesn't have your key, he sticks his own lock on it with his own key and sends it back to you. You then remove your lock and send it back, where your neighbor can then unlock his lock and pull out the note. So even though the briefcase could be intercepted, it remains locked the entire time that it's in transit. All right, enough talking. Let's get that.
Okay, this is how the SSH work, where the sender has a public key and sender sends it with the message. Then receiver has a private key which will be locked. Then the public key will be removed by the sender. Then private key will be removed by the receiver and the message will be unblocked. So that is how SSH does. And after this, a tunnel is established between the sender and the receiver, and further communication happens through that tunnel. So that is how the SSH works. The advantage of SSH is it allows you to access Raspberry Pi through your PC without having to connect a separate monitor for it. In one terminal on PC, you can execute client commands, and the other terminal, like you can use a terminal called as PuTTY, we will study about that. And on that terminal, you can execute several commands, server commands. And the keyboard and mouse also can be one set. That means you need not have to switch the keyboard and mouse from Raspberry Pi to PC and PC to Raspberry Pi. So your keyboard and mouse can be connected to PC, and you will be using two terminals on your single PC to work with the Raspberry Pi and PC as well. So that is wonderful, right? So let us see how you can do that. So for establishing such a connection, you need to know your IP address of the Raspberry Pi. To know that IP address, you need to use a command called ipconfig. Here, ipconfig is executed. So on executing the ipconfig, you will know your internet INET address. So this is the INET address. It will be displayed when you execute ifconfig. So when you execute this command, you will be getting the IP address, which you can note, which will be used for further executions. So then you will say sudo Raspberry Pi config to configure the Raspberry Pi. Then you will come to the configuration tool window, where you will get the options for changing user password, host name, boot options, etc. So now you'll have to choose this option, interfacing options, fifth option you need to choose. After that, you will get this list of this list of operations. You can access the, you can configure the camera, VNC, I2C, SPI, etc. So now we will choose the SSH. So we need to configure the SSH. So we will choose the SSH. So you can choose the SSH and enable or disable the remote command line. For that purpose, you will use the SSH. So after that, it will ask, would you like to the SSH server to be enabled? It will ask this question. So now you will say yes. So after that, it will say SSH server is enabled, and you say okay, then finish. So after that, as I said, you need another terminal, say PuTTY, which is used for working on Windows with Raspberry Pi. So now you can download, it is open source, you can download PuTTY. PuTTY is like, it is a teleterminal. We have studied in Unix about TTY, right? TTY command we have studied, which is teletype. So the teletype means remote screen. PuTTY is a free and open source terminal emulator, serial console, and network file transfer application for Windows platform. So you can connect Raspberry Pi on Windows or Mac or Linux, so using different utilities. So PuTTY is used for Windows platform to connect through SSH the Raspberry Pi. It supports several protocols. This PuTTY supports several protocols like SCP, SSH, Telnet, RLogin, and raw socket connections. So TTY, as we have studied in Unix, it stands for teletypewriter, or teletype we can say. It is used for printing file name of the terminal. So you need to download it, you need to install the PuTTY, and then you can start using the PuTTY to establish SSH connection through your PC and the Raspberry Pi. So after this, you need to, we have noted our IP address earlier, right? So this IP address you need to enter in the configuration of PuTTY. So you have to go to the configuration window of PuTTY, and then you need to enter your IP address so that the connection is established, and by default the port is 22 for TCP connections. So after that, you will get the PuTTY terminal, where you will enter the login name as Pi and the password is Raspberry. As we have discussed earlier, the default your login ID and password, and you will get the Raspberry Pi command line for executing the commands. This is how you can use SSH and PuTTY for establishing a secure connection through your PC and the Raspberry Pi. Now let us talk about smart and connected cities. So this is the last section of our syllabus in the fifth module. This section we will study about utilities in smart city and its architecture also we'll study. Smart city is an urban area that uses different types of electronic IoT sensors to collect the data and use insights gained from that data to manage assets, resources, and services efficiently, making it citizen friendly and sustainable. The data collected from citizens, devices, buildings, and assets, and they are processed and analyzed to monitor and manage traffic and transportation systems, power plants, utilities, water supply networks, waste management, crime detection, information systems, schools, hospitals, and other community services. This will enhance the quality and performance of urban services and reduce costs and reduce also consumption of resources, and increase contact between the citizens and the government, as government will look after all these services. The major technological and economic and environmental changes have generated increased interest in smart cities, including climate change, economic restructuring, coronavirus, online retail, entertainment, aging population, and pressure on the public finance. Let us study about the smart city, its utilities, services, and architecture. The vertical IoT needs for smart cities. So what are the verticals of smart cities? What utilities it will provide? What applications are to be done? So let us see. The solution for city management start at the street level, right? Sensors that capture the data on everything from parking space availability to water purity. So this we have discussed in the previous slide, right? What are the different areas which are covered in the smart city? So it will cover from parking space management to water purity, water the pollution control, garbage management, everything. Data analytics is also used extensively, for example, to reduce crime or to improve the traffic flows, right? Data analytics. So we have seen in the previous slide that the data from different sensors which are deployed in different parts of the smart city will be gathered, and the analytics of that data will be done extensively, and the problems like crime and traffic management will be dealt with by the insights of that data. The citizens can use tools to leverage their smart mobile devices, such as report problems and make recommendations for improving urban life. So through your smartphones or any other gadgets, smart devices, you can report the problems what you are facing in your city, in your area, and you can also make recommendations for improving the urban. You can give suggestions for improving the urban life. Or also you can locate available parking spaces by using your smart devices. So these smart solutions can have a transformative impact on the quality of life, right? So if these facilities are available, definitely it will impact our quality of life, efficiency of the life. A recent Cisco study, as illustrated in this figure, expects IoT to have following economic impact over 10-year period. So in another 10-year period, so what impact does IoT do, economic impact IoT do on these areas? Let us see: smart buildings, gas monitoring, smart parking, water management, and road pricing. So these are, this is given in a pie graph. So here smart buildings, it is given in dollars, $100. It will affect economy of $100. Gas monitoring, $69. Smart parking, $41. $100 billion, $100 billion, $69 billion, $41 billion. Then water management, $39 billion, and road pricing, $18 billion. So these is the economic impact of smart city of IoT in another 10 years. So let us study all of them in detail. So let us go with the smart buildings. Smart buildings have the potential to save $100 billion by lowering operating cost, by reducing energy consumption. If smartly utilized, energy consumption can be reduced, right? We have seen that AC example. AC in my house and neighbor house will be alternatively switched on and switch off. In such case, energy consumption will be less, right? Through the efficient integration of heating, ventilation, air conditioning, so all those things efficiently, if they are utilized, the power consumption can be reduced in smart buildings, and other building infrastructure systems also can be handled smartly. Note that the financial gain applies to city budgets only when the building is city owned, right? So when financial gain to be done, then city the building should be owned by the city. However, the reduced emissions benefit the city regardless of who owns the building. City in the sense government, right? So whoever owns the building, city will be benefited. But if a building need to be benefited, then it should be owned by the city, centralized. Then gas monitoring. So centralized gas monitoring. Monitoring gas could save $69 billion by reducing meter reading costs. So automatically meter reading is done based on the consumption. Increasing the accuracy of readings for citizens. So exactly it can be even point consumptions can also be monitored by the municipal utility agencies. The financial benefit is obvious for users and utility companies when utility is managed by the city. The very important advantage is in terms of safety, because it is centralized, and safety will be of utmost importance regardless of who operates the utility. Safety will be utmost, will be taken care of. In cases of sudden consumption increase, a timely alert. So suddenly if more gas consumption is done, an alert can be given to emergency response teams, and they may be dispatched soon, and the problems or the issues can be avoided. Disastrous incidents can be avoided. So safety will be increased. Then smart parking. Smart parking could create $41 billion by providing real-time visibility into parking space availability across the city. So, you know, if you go to the center of the city, Bangalore city, you will definitely face parking problems. You will have to keep rotating streets by street to find out the parking. Even in metros or any other malls where the huge amount of vehicles come into parking, so you'll have to wait until somebody vacates the vehicle, or you have to keep searching for the parking place. So that can be avoided. So visibility where the parking is available, so directly you can go to that place and you can park the vehicles rather than searching throughout the parking lot for free parking space. Residents can identify and reserve the closest available space. So wherever the closest free parking space is there, they can go to that place and park. Then traffic wardens can identify non-complaint usage, so complaints will not be there. Then municipalities can introduce demand-based pricing also for parking. So if the demand for the parking is more, they can increase the parking price. If it is less, they can decrease the parking price dynamically. So that can also be done. The next utility is water management. Smart water management could save $39 billion connecting household water meters over an IP network to provide remote usage and status information. So now in Bangalore city, most of the areas have Kaveri water supply, right? So there they'll be fixing a meter for gauging the usage of the water. So based on the usage of the water, the bill will be generated, and it can be connected to internet, and it can be operated smartly also. Then the benefit with these features such as real-time consumption visibility will be there. So they can monitor, so what will be the requirement of water for the particular area, they can monitor. And if there is a leakage in any particular area, in any particular pipeline, then it can be detected and it can be fixed as soon as possible to avoid the problems caused and the water wastage. A gate or a pump can be opened and closed remotely and automatically in real time, right? So there can need not be a manual maintenance. Automatically the pump or a valve or a gate can be opened and closed according to the requirement based on the analytics data. And vibrations can be measured to detect and predict potential equipment failures. Any vibrations are there based on the variations in the vibration, so failures can be detected. Then repair team can be dispatched as soon as possible to fix the failure, and damages loss can be reduced. Then the road pricing. Road pricing, cities could create $18 billion in new revenues by implementing automatic payments as vehicles enter busy city zones while improving overall traffic conditions. Right, so now in tolls especially we have fast tags. So there, if manually toll charges are collected, and you need to take the money, you need to give back the change, and you have to open the gate, close the gate, isn't it? So all that takes a lot of time, and in peak time, peak weekends or festival times, the toll will be having a huge crowd. In order to avoid such problems and waiting time of the vehicles, so such fast tags facility can be given and it can be smartly monitored. Real-time traffic condition is very valuable and actionable information, right? That can be used to proactively reroute public transportation services or private users. So like if in a particular area, in a particular road, if there is a huge traffic, we can give instructions to the vehicles to take some other route, alternative route for reaching their destinations, which will reduce the traffic and wastage of time. So these are all the verticals of smart city IoT. Let us see the IoT architecture in the next class. Thank you all. Have a good day. Bye.